Easter 1967. 16 miles from Land's End, Torry Canyon ends her week-long crucifixion on the Seven Stones Reef. She breaks her back and spills 50,000 tons of crude oil. She'd been shedding oil copiously all week, the first of it now ashore, painting a black girdle around the coastline. A society that depended on oil was nevertheless outraged. It sought revenge. All that was left of a 1,000-foot-long supertanker clung stubbornly to the reef for some days. Then she yielded to the Atlantic swell and slipped, unseen, into a mercantile graveyard where many have gone before. Naval pilots had a big hand in the destruction of Torry Canyon. Today, a newer generation flies over the spot regularly on training flights. It's over 14 years now since the Torry Canyon went down. There have been other tanker disasters, of course, but none caught the imagination of the world quite like the Torry Canyon in 1967. You can count the cost of that crisis in terms of physical effort and hard cash, but at best all we achieved was a massive clearing up operation. Any damage to the ecology had to be left to nature to put right. Well, today we're going back to see how well she healed the scars and just what's left of that 120,000 ton supertanker. We're over her now, well, roughly anyway, because nothing marks the spot. Once the pollard rock, tallest of the reef's grim fangs, broke surface here at low tide, but no more. A supertanker off course at 18 knots and a blitz of high explosive saw to that. We'll have to find her amid the labyrinth of the Seven Stones, and our marker boy will guide us back to the helicopter. Navy can't wait forever. It'll have to be a quick trip, and we'll need some luck too. Well, it's a wreck all right, but ships have met their fate here for centuries. Could this be the legendary maritime juggernaut which so brutally awoke mankind to the risks of modern civilization? Or is it some humbler, long-forgotten victim of the reef? This looks like a stern section, and from a ship of some size. No anonymous little coaster. But Torry Canyon was 1,000 feet long, and there isn't that much here. Nature has begun to hide whatever wounds dispatched her to the bottom. Kelp and weed obscure the telltale clues that might disclose her name and fate. The stern. Now will she reveal herself? Torry Canyon, or at least this part of her, rests on a ledge near the bottom of Pollard Rock, the most infamous of the seven stones. 80 feet of water shield her from the notoriety which the world above still holds for her. We'll visit her again in the summer when tides and currents allow a longer, closer acquaintance with one of the biggest shipwrecks in the world. At the peak of the holiday season, it's not easy to turn your back on all the attractions of the Isles of Scilly. But now the tides are the slackest of the month, and our expedition is ready to put to sea. With the use of an ideal craft, the Scavenger, and the enthusiastic support of her skipper, Mac Mace, from the off-island of Briar. He's not just a good boatman, he's an experienced diver too, so our return to Torry Canyon couldn't be better prepared. We could have wished for better weather, though. A keen wind has held us up for a day or two, and it's still pretty fresh. But if we don't go now, we might have to wait for another month. Heading for the Seven Stones, there's time to reflect on the disaster that nearly befell these beautiful islands back in 1967. A wind from a different direction could have swept 100,000 tons of crude oil onto the doorsteps of every islander. Now we're over the same spot and ready for a more leisurely visit to the monster we became acquainted with in the spring. Time for Jeff and I to get the gear ready. Air bottles, camera and lights. But the decision to dive or not won't rest with us. Mac, our skipper, will decide. He knows the water, and as a seasoned diver himself, he weighs the risks. Conditions are not perfect, and they almost need to be in a spot where the Atlantic swell lifts over the reef with the weight of an ocean behind it. The diving hatch is open, one last check of the charts, and Mac makes his decision. Okay to dive. The central hatch between the Scavenger's twin hulls is a real boon in such lumpy conditions. An easy way out and an easy way back. Torry Canyon, we know, broke into three before she slipped off the Pollard Rock. Scavenger wallows in the slack tide just northeast of the Pollard. Down here then, hopefully, we'll find the tanker's bow section. This big could only be Torry Canyon's. Hundreds of tons of it must have spewed from the bombed and buckled forecastle when the bow section hit the seabed 80 feet below the surface. Follow it, and we must find either her enormous anchor or her bows. We found the hull, part of the bows, the deck squashed almost to the floor by the battering from man and nature. But there's every indication here that nature's recovered. Sponges, anemones, weed and hydroid, all signs of a balanced ecology again. Port anchor winch, powerful enough to lift all that chain, now meekly surrenders to the march of time, clad in the autumnal camouflage of underwater life. But the starboard winch still grimly grips its chain as if ready to weigh anchor, refusing to believe it will never turn again. With a mental picture of those winches on the foredeck, we've a better grasp now of how Torry Canyon is lying, and in which direction to head for the tangled midship section. Sponges and anemones, sisters of the wind, clad these parts of the wreck. And flowing weed decorates, one might say graces, the hard geometric shapes man has consigned to the seabed. Every wreck, even the humblest trawler, seems to emit an aura of lonely desolation. You can almost feel it through the water. The shame at having let someone down. Fanciful? Perhaps. But around Torry Canyon, the mood is of something deeper. Despair, even disgrace. We're moving back along the hull now, heading for the midship section, which sank in deeper water. The mighty oil tanks which took the full force of the pounding of jet fighters. Those pilots are too old now to be still flying Hunters and Sea Venoms. In 1967, they had probably the only chance in their careers to attack a real ship with real bombs and rockets. Here, amid the debris at the deepest part of the wreck site, is a solid reminder of the anger society bestowed on Torry Canyon. A 1,000-pound bomb, one of dozens which rained on the luckless tanker as retribution for the trouble she'd caused. This one will sleep beside its intended victim forever. The other bombs were more efficient, and the world saw in Torry Canyon's destruction an awesome demonstration of modern firepower, echoing the faraway war in Vietnam. Bombs and rockets ruptured the hull, blowing apart the few remaining tanks which held oil. Napalm, the ugly scourge of Vietnam, fed the flames, incinerating all that was left of a fine ship and her irksome cargo. Canyon had taught the world a painful lesson. The response had been to burn down the school. And in the wake of that Easter holiday, she gave up the ghost with the dread hallmark of man's ultimate capacity to destroy. a mushroom of devastation. Now her dismembered carcass sulks in a cold, inhospitable grave. Gone, but not forgotten. How many skippers of how many super tankers at sea today are haunted by the spectre of this ignoble wreck? And the knowledge that it has happened since and will, without a doubt, happen again. Torry Canyon's eternal distinction is that she was the first such ecological disaster. Her body, contorted into weird and chilling profiles, still sends a warning from the grave about the risks of the society we've chosen to live in. Once, on this bridge, men had at their disposal all the modern near foolproof aids to navigation. Radio, radar, up-to-date charts marking the Seven Stones Reef as a maritime death trap. A lightship marked the limits of safe passage, only a few miles away. Yet here she lies, silent, unseen testimony to the fact that man can be more fallible than the technology he's developed to help him. And that a man in a hurry is more fallible than most. The shortcut Torry Canyon took to catch the tide at Milford Haven ended here. The sheer size of the wreck is staggering, more like a Blitz factory than a ship. In the end, perhaps, that's all she was, and her agony continues every winter with every storm that hurls itself from the depths of the Atlantic onto this exposed and barren reef. Ahead of us now, the remains of the engine room, blown up even before the jets arrived by an explosion which crippled the tanker and claimed the only life in the whole tragic story, a salvage man who'd come to help. It's a vast scrapyard, the ledge littered with the heaviest bits of metal from the whole ship. How many years, how many centuries before the vessel's enormous engine block succumbs to the relentless corrosion of seawater? Once it drove 120,000 tons through the water at 18 knots. Now it's an impotent monument to the perils of progress. This part of the ship, the deck just forward of the crew's quarters, has suffered least from the bombing and winter storms. An access hatch offers the chance of a glimpse inside. The hatch is wide and unobstructed, an open invitation to explore further, but an invitation to be treated with suspicion. Perhaps a quick look, though. Not too far, because we've no line to guide us out again if we lose our bearings in dark, collapsing companionways. Ladders and stairways are a particular hazard. Often the first part of a wreck to corrode, they can give way at a touch and blocked the way out with a tangle of heavy ironwork. A wreck this big can all too easily become a tomb. You wouldn't be human if you didn't feel nervous at moments like this. Fish have no such fears. But curiously, even they find something intimidating about Torry Canyon. Such a wreck is usually teeming with marine life, as any angler knows. Conger in the dark companionways, pollock shoaling above in spiraling silver columns. Crabs and lobsters in every nook and cranny. But here there's nothing, and no one can tell us why. Even eminent marine biologists are lost for an answer. The last of the tanker's oil was washed out years ago. Nothing toxic or objectionable remains. Yet fish happily established on the nearby reef show no inclination to move into the wreck. Strange. There's a strong temptation to swim on and on through these cavernous passageways, like a tourist trying to visit every small corner of a vast cathedral. But divers lured onward and downward by such seductive ideas have lost their lives. Get lost in this cathedral and you can't shout for help. The thought of such a fate breaks the spell and we're outside again in no time. Here, by the crew's quarters, those 1,000-pounders ripped out the port side of Torry Canyon. The starboard side stands in the lee of the reef, sculpted by high explosives into a gaunt exhibition of surrealist art. Strange how something as inelegant as an oil tanker, and one wrecked and blown to bits at that, can assume the role of modern art. The bric-a-brac of shipboard life, once taken for granted, there to do a job, becomes under 100 feet of water, shapes divorced from all purpose, seabed sculptures. Wrecks are like that, and this one more than most. Stunned forever by the violent transition from a highly valued, hard-working tool of mankind to a pile of rejected iron. This doorway, starboard of the crew's quarters, is the highest part of the wreck, only about 60 feet from the surface. The light is stronger here and fosters what meagre animal life the tanker can attract for company. Nothing much free swimming, just a colony of clinging sea anemones and sponges. Torry Canyon is host only to the humblest forms of sea life. It's not much to show for all those years in the lee of the Seven Stones Reef. Yet once, in the Torry Canyon's last moments afloat, this doorway must have seen all the frantic activity that accompanies a ship going aground. The crew, some roused from slumber, rushing through here from their quarters to the safety of the deck. Watching anxiously as the ship's great engine was put into reverse, her one huge propeller thrashing ineffectively at the water, as she tried hopelessly to fall back off the rock that transfixed her. The crew's quarters were the last part of the ship to submit to man and nature. The last the world saw of a mighty tanker whose name had made headlines in every continent. With this, the last glimpse of the wreck in mind, we'll head for the broken stern section. sensations are heightened underwater. And here we have a distinct feeling that we're returning to familiar ground. That part of the wreck we visited so briefly in the spring. We miss this, though. Torry Canyon's enormous rudder sheared at the pintles after sending her on that last fatal change of course. We hadn't dived this deep in the spring, but the rudder means we must be directly under the tanker's tilted stern. Close, very close to the point where we embarked on our long tour of discovery. The feeling is like reaching the peak of an inaccessible mountain. Few people have ever, or will ever, come here and gaze on the name of what was once the biggest wreck in maritime history. Fewer still, I suppose, will come here twice in a matter of months and explore the whole length of her. And yet our feelings are mixed. This is the stern rail, our very first, and now our last glimpse of Torry Canyon underwater. So there's a sense of achievement at completing our bow to stern survey of this huge vessel. But there's something else too. Relief that we can now leave the tanker to her gloomy, brooding desolation. It is not a wreck we shall want to visit again. There is about her a compelling air of wounded martyrdom for all the reputations she destroyed. There's no such thing as a happy wreck, but some manage to retain a little pride. Torry Canyon has none. Her eternal curse is to shoulder all the guilt for the way modern society chose to live, and for the price it once had to pay.